Hey, good evening, everybody. Now, there we go. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our next session here on the Let's Do It World Conference. This is day three of our conference, and so far we've had some incredible speakers, incredible presentations from all over the world. Lots of unique perspectives, and I think it's fair to say a lot of inspirational talks as well. There's been a lot of emotional comments in the chat section. People really have been struck by a lot of what's been said so far, and this is going to be a fascinating one, because last World Cleanup Day, when we had it in Tallinn, Estonia, we really focused on cigarette butt littering. And I, for one, was astounded by the sheer numbers and volumes of the cigarette butt problem across the world. So we've got great speakers across this session. Some housekeeping rules. We are now officially recording this session, and it's also being streamed live on YouTube and Facebook as well. So just so you're aware of that, if you ask a question after some of the speakers, which you'll have the opportunity to do so, well, then just know that it is being streamed and it could be published later on. And also, if you're here, turn on your cameras, not just your sound, so we can see each other and it feels like we're really all together. And I'm looking at a screen here, and you're such a good looking bunch, everyone. I'm the only odd one out, but the rest of you, it's amazing. So everyone have their cameras on, and we're going to have a great session. And we're starting, if you were in the room a few minutes ago, we said hello to him. Good morning. I think it's 6 a.m. in the morning. Thomas, he is a professor in the United States of America, and he's talking about tobacco's impact on the environment. So rather than me introduce him, he can do it much better than anyone. Thomas, it's early there, but I know you'll shine. We're handing over to you.
Okay, and I'm going to share my screen right away and get started here. And it's a good morning for me, but probably the afternoon for most of you. And it's a real pleasure to be part of this conference. Looks pretty exciting all the way through. And I'm going to be talking to you today about my favorite thing, which is the environment, but my most unfavorite thing, cigarette butts, which is more impactful than most people realize, even though they're just tiny little pieces of trash. I've been doing this now for maybe a decade, and have an NGO called the Cigarette Butt Pollution Project. You'll be able to find that. And I've got a slide later at the end that will give you the website. But I just wanted to emphasize that it's not just butts. I mean, tobacco is a full service environmental insult, just as it is a full service health insult to the human body. Everything from tobacco growing, which is very hard on the soil, and also utilizes child labor a lot, and has a lot of social justice issues attached to it as a result of that. Cigarette production is actually a very dirty process. Just by making cigarettes, for instance, lower in nicotine, it means that you produce the nicotine as a byproduct, which is actually a poisonous chemical. Cigarette transportation, if you think about all the multinational trade going on in tobacco, there's all sorts of transportation and delivery and distribution costs resulting in carbon burdens as well. Cigarette consumption, I think everybody knows the health consequences of tobacco use, but there's also the secondhand consequences, which actually the second most common cause of lung cancer is secondhand smoke, not radon or anything else as far as a pulmonary pathogen or pulmonary insult. Secondhand smoke. And then we have something called thirdhand smoke, which is the residual of tobacco in buildings or cars or any place else that it's smoked, which doesn't go away. And it actually incorporates itself into the surface areas that make it, persistently a toxin. And then what we're talking about today is tobacco waste. And this can be more than just cigarette butts, as we'll mention. But nevertheless, every year in the coastal cleanups, and you allude to some of these statistics already, Colm, cigarettes, especially the filter, which is non-biodegradable plastic, is the single most picked up item over the last 30 years every year. It's about a third by count, not by weight, but by count, of all the stuff that's picked up from beach and other kinds of cleanups throughout the world. And yet it just continues to persist as if it's the it's the last sort of acceptable form of littering in the world. And it's always, a question in my mind is, why do people do this? Well, we've actually done some studies to help to understand that. But one of the main reasons is that they don't realize that the cigarette is made of plastic. and is therefore mostly non-biodegradable. And we know that from surveys, that is national or local or small scale surveys that indicate that only about 25 to 30% of people realize that the cigarette filter is made of plastic. And what's really also sort of worth noting is that despite the fact that we made so much progress in getting people to quit smoking and advising them about their health, global cigarette consumption is going up. It's going up mostly in the developing countries, that is lower income countries, where targeted marketing by the tobacco industry is successful at trans-border advertising, distribution, marketing. They're not going away. And despite what they say or what new products they make, cigarettes are still the number one source of income for them and will be for decades to come. Well, so how many butts are there in the world? Well, there's 6 trillion cigarettes that are manufactured and sold. That is the ones that we know about. And also that doesn't count roll your own tobacco or pipe tobacco or cigars or anything like that. That's just cigarettes. More than 97% globally are filtered. So hardly any cigarettes are unfiltered. And so again, we're dealing with this plastic filter that comes in all sorts of forms, but mainly is still made of cellulose acetate, the plastic. And are they a health problem? Well, there might be. We'll suggest this to you as we go along, but dogs, pets are indiscriminate eaters. My dog used to every once in a while sniff out a cigarette butt. Children have been known to actually consume cigarette butts purposefully or accidentally, and have been actually reported to have poisonings. We've got reports of emergency rooms where children have consumed cigarette butts, believe it or not, and suffered from nicotine toxicity. At any rate, yeah, besides that more unlikely condition, we know that they can get into the environment, and do they cause any harm or do they cause any exposures during that? And we'll talk about that. Well, how much waste is that? Well, 20 cigarettes weighs about 3.5 grams. Here in the US, that means with 270 billion cigarettes sold in the US, it's about almost 50,000 metric tons. And I looked up Estonia's burden on this, and it was 970 metric tons. But this doesn't include the remnant tobacco, the packages, the lighters, the matches, other tobacco products, including e-cigarettes or smokeless tobacco products. So there's other stuff that's in the tobacco product waste kind of burden. And you know, it's worth looking at that, especially e-cigarettes. And if we have time, I'll talk a little bit more about that. Well, do they have any effects on the environment? Well, it's easy to think about the aquatic environment, especially because what we've done and what most of the laboratory work has been done to assess cigarette butt toxicity is looks at the leachates. That is sort of like a cigarette butt or cigarette filter as a sort of a tea bag where it leaches out all the compounds that the filter has taken from the smoke. And these contain heavy metals and nicotine and 40 different chemicals. The FDA, our Food and Drug Administration, just did a study actually to quantify what those chemicals were coming out into the environment. Because the FDA now has regulatory authority over tobacco products, they are responsible to do environmental assessments. And they've finally gotten into that and fortunately now are producing some good science that we can actually understand what the chemical toxicities are. This can contaminate water systems everywhere, streams, even the ocean, sediments under lakes, et cetera. And what has been seen is that seabirds, turtles, pets, other animals, actually do sometimes consume these things, and they've been found inside the body cavities of a variety of birds and other aquatic creatures especially. In the laboratory, they've been found to be toxic to even the smallest organisms, microorganisms, water fleas, which are sort of on the bottom of the food chain. And you know, this is not unusual and this is not surprising because nicotine has been used as a pesticide for plants for years. It's actually banned here in the United States now. And besides these chemical toxicities and theoretical kind of poisonings, they're a nuisance. They're a source of environmental degradation. And actually the word public nuisance applies to them. This is a source perhaps of a litigation basis, and it's something that I think we should think more about actually. And besides that, there's cleanup costs. And I think everybody who does butt pickups or waste pickups realizes that there's enormous amount of time that's put into this. Cities or their schools or institutions are responsible for this cleanup. Not the tobacco industry, but really those who are oftentimes not smokers, in fact. And there's a cost to this that we are actually looking at this now. We just started an environmental economic project to try to cost out what are the burdens of tobacco product waste cleanup or environmental damage going forward. And this is going to be something that I'm really excited to try to produce some data on this. But we've done some other things, and I just want to give you one little example here where we unfortunately killed some fish. And we use both saltwater and freshwater fish in our labs to do an Environmental Protection Agency study that assesses whether or not cigarette butt leachates, the chemicals in the cigarette butts, are lethal. And this allows us to say whether or not this is a hazardous product. And what we used was a sort of a dilutional experiment over 96 hours where cigarette butts were soaked in water at different concentrations. And then fish were carefully prepared laboratory sort of subjects that were fed and oxygenated, et cetera, all very carefully done. And what we found was that over this period of 96 hours, that one cigarette butt dissolved, or rather leached in a liter of water, one cigarette butt in a liter of water killed half the fish that were exposed to it. That's what's called the lethal dose 50, which by definition from this EPA, this Environmental Protection Agency study protocol would cause this to be called hazardous toxic waste. So I don't think there's any question about it. And no one's saying that cigarettes are not harmful, but what we're also saying now is that they are harmful to the environment. And there may be some other effects that we're studying, actually sublethal effects. We're actually doing some studies here at San Diego to see if there's bioaccumulation in the food chain potentially, where we've been exposing mussels and other kinds of aquatic organisms to see whether or not the chemicals actually can build up in the body of these animals and be then possibly transmitted through consumption. And in fact, we have found that that is potentially possible. We've got a publication coming out on that very shortly. Now, the other thing that's interesting here is this biotransformation. And this is a, sort of a funny thing to think about, but nicotine by itself is a poison. What it can do is transform it to something called tobacco-specific nitrosamines. And this is what people are smoking also and getting lung cancer from it and other kinds of cancers. And it may actually be in the environment as well. Now, you may think, well, this is not very much stuff, but we're always looking for environmental potential possibilities that could lead to, more population effects on cancer risk and incidence. And so it's not inconceivable that this could have some effects. This was a photo a couple of years ago, actually picked up by a National Audubon Society photographer who actually found a bird feeding its chick a cigarette butt. This is out in front of my hotel in Stockholm. I was there about a year and a half ago, and you can see that, there's not just cigarette butts, but snus packages. And these are another source of interest as well. So what we've been doing mostly, and so many of you I know have been involved in butt cleanups and trying to figure out what to do with all this trash and get it picked up. This is an externality from the tobacco industry's profit making operation. That means the impacts of the cigarette butt waste are borne by those who aren't necessarily part of that transaction. And the tobacco industry has no responsibility. They may fund some environmental groups, in fact, but what ends up happening is that we do cleanups and we may want to do recycling on these. I noticed one of our speakers is going to be talking about that. We have a group called TerraCycle here in the United States that's been trying this too. Some people have suggested deposit return schemes, just like on bottles and cans. And then even Philip Morris, our good friends with the largest, world's largest tobacco company, have said that they'd like to have their production of plastic by 2030 in the future. And, you know, it all sounds good, but really what they're relying on when you read their website on this is more pickups, funding groups to pick up their trash, and, you know, pushing governments to enforce pickups and not preventing the issue, which is what we really think about in public health as being much more effective than downstream sort of tertiary kind of interventions. And I don't mean to say that these are not worth doing. And in fact, I on my campus every year, I send the students out to pick up cigarette butts, and we pick up like 20,000 a year, every year, even when the campus went smoke-free. And so it's not without value. It really raises the level of awareness, but it's not gonna solve the problem. We do campaigns, and this whole meeting is a campaign on the issue of trash, and especially on tobacco products, but using social media and you know, pointing out how important this is. And we've done things like banning outdoor smoking. All of our beaches in California now are supposedly smoke-free, but there's no enforcement. And so we still see that, and the signage and et cetera are not very well done. We have anti-litter laws here in California. If you are caught dumping a cigarette butt, you could be fined up to $1,000. I had actually one of my colleagues who says he smokes a cigarillo once a year was caught driving down the Berkeley Pier with his cigarillo in his wife's Prius, and it has no ashtray. So he flicked it out, and behind him was a Berkeley policeman who busted him. He had to go to court. He had to pay $500 fine and a day of public service for littering a cigarette butt. But that happens very rarely. He's sort of the poster boy for me on this. Take back and recycling, as I mentioned. And one other issue that it has not been supported widely, but San Francisco actually levied a 20 cent per pack litter fee, where they actually based this on an econometric study. And this has been raised up to, I think, 70 cents per pack litter fee, which has several effects. It helps fund the cleanup programs, which then resolves this externality, but it also reduces tobacco consumption because the price goes up and consumption goes down. But messaging is important. I ran into this fellow in the streets in London, and I talked to him about cigarettes. He didn't have any cigarette butts up here, but he was mostly very enthusiastic about including cigarette butts as this plastic effort. The EU, as you know, has a plastics directive, which sort of walks around the tobacco issue, although I think that there's more studies to be needed to show what that plastics potentially ban on those plastics might involve. But what the most important thing is, I think, to make sure that people understand that they're non-biodegradable and toxic. So I think there need to be more environmental regulations. Plastics directive is one way to do that, hazardous waste restrictions, product regulations. It is possible that the sale of filtered cigarettes, so the filter itself, has no health value whatsoever. In fact, it actually increases some forms of lung cancer incidence. And so we could get rid of it. And here in California, we actually have a few cities that have banned all sales of tobacco products. Berkeley, or rather not Berkeley, but they will, but Beverly Hills, for instance, and Manhattan Beach in Los Angeles County have banned the sale of all products. So it can be done. It's not, nobody's gonna die from that. Nobody's gonna go out of business from that, but it is something that we should look at as part of what we call the end game on tobacco. Possible litigation. And this is where I'm headed with our economic study. I hope that there'll be communities that decide that they want to recover the costs that they've borne from tobacco use and tobacco product waste, and to have it, you know, come back to them as a reimbursement. So in conclusion, I just want to point out again, tobacco product waste is toxic, non-biodegradable waste. That includes the e-cigarettes. And, you know, what we know about them is that they have lithium batteries, they have nicotine, they have plastics, they have heavy metals. And what's really interesting about that is that here in California, the schools are responsible for picking the stuff up off the school grounds, but also confiscating it from students who are not supposed to be using it. They then become what's called hazardous waste generators. They become responsible to dispose of this stuff as hazardous waste and transport it and train their people. So, and another, it's again, another externality. So we need upstream solutions, not just cleanups. Those are important and really helpful in keeping us aware of this problem. And what we need to do is engage in extended producer responsibility, which is something in Europe that has been quite effective in terms of making the responsibility for the product from the manufacturer to the post-consumption waste the responsibility of the industry and not the responsibility of the consumer or governments or non-governmental organizations. And that means local action actually needs to be best taken on this for the regulatory and litigation purposes. So I'll stop there and give you one of my favorite pictures from the Surfers Against Sewage in the UK, who loaned this to me. And there's our website, sigwaste.org. And thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to engaging in questions when we have a chance.
There you go, Thomas. Thank you so much for that fantastic presentation. I know we're going to have a lot of questions on it. You can stop sharing your screen now, if that's okay, Thomas, so we can see you again. Rapturous applause from the crowd. A quick question. What was it you said? One cigarette butt in 1 liter of water. How many fish? You're going to have to unmute yourself again, Thomas.
Kills half the fish. 1 liter, one butt in a liter of water soaked for 96 hours kills half the fish. That's called the lethal dose 50. And that's a criteria for calling it hazardous waste.
Okay. And, you know, I live here in Rome in Italy, and everybody smokes over here. And it's funny because people who would say to you they would never litter in a million years, so they would never take a piece of paper and throw it on the ground, don't think twice about a cigarette butt because they just don't see it as litter. How do you change a mindset like that when the people genuinely, if you ask them, well-meaning people would say, oh, I don't litter. They don't see it as littering at all.
Well, I think that I think that they don't realize what they're doing with the plastic piece. I mean, again, as I mentioned, most people who smokers and non-smokers, well, non-smokers more recently do, they don't know that it's non-biodegradable plastic. And the other thing is that there's no good way of disposing of these things. If you you can't carry them around with you very easily, they smell like heck. And, then waste bins, even though they may be posted every 50 feet along the road, people don't walk more than a few feet in order to get rid of that waste. So this is a tough problem, which is why it has to be dealt with, you know, from the prevention of this. The ideal thing is everybody to quit smoking. That's what we do in public health. But short of that, more regulatory approaches the police don't really want to be busting people for littering cigarette butts. But, you know, you do that a few times and the word spreads and, you know, it becomes more normalized to not do it.
Your friend who was used as the poster boy in California when he was fined $500, did you feel any sympathy for him?
No, I wanted to use his name and make a picture of him, but he wouldn't let me.
But that's on the extreme side, isn't it? $500. Well, yeah. Enough for me. Let's put it out to the floor. Would anyone like to ask a question to Professor Thomas? Just unmute your microphone, tell us your name and where you're from, and ask your question. I can see people moving. People are always shy to be the first one. Would anyone like to ask a question? Or maybe the presentation was so comprehensive, we don't have any questions. But
hello from Estonia. Mart is here.
Mart, over to you.
Yeah, well, later on, I just wanted to point out we will have a panel discussion on the same topic, right? That's about after an hour or so. So we can get the questions then as well.
Correct, yes. But if anyone would like to ask one question that comes into their mind straight after the talk.
I do. We get the
panel. Yes, Stephanie, where are you from, Stephanie?
Yeah, Colm, thank you. I was wondering, was there any kind of research where you could see in how far the cigarette butts have entered into the flesh, the stomach of fish that we are finally eating? Do you know anything about that?
Not yet. We've got a couple of things going on right now for research. One, we're looking at there's several steps where, you know, these, we have to measure things. And one step we're measuring now is soil and water contamination in natural resource areas. We have several natural protected areas in California where they're administered by the University of California. And so we've now engaged in a study looking at whether we can find the toxic chemicals in the soil, in the water, or in the sediments of these natural areas. So that's one step towards being able to identify the actual insult to living creatures. That would be the next step after that. Again, there's been a number of reports of animals that have been fish and other things, turtles, birds, et cetera, where we've actually found cigarette butts in them. Yes, so those reports are there. Now, when it comes to the chemical sort of into the life cycle, that hasn't been done yet, but there's every reason to actually go after that as well as another investigation.
Thank you, Stephanie. Good question. Any other questions before we move on to our next speaker?
Yeah, I have a question too.
Go ahead, Chun. Where are you, Chun?
I'm Chun Hui from Singapore. Yeah, so I have a question. So in Singapore recently, secondhand smoke is becoming a more increasing social issue, especially with the working from home, many people, and in Singapore, many people live in apartments. So if somebody is smoking from his house, sometimes another person can smell it or is breathing in the smoke. Is there any research finding on, the impact based on distance? How far should you be from, or how close should you be from another person smoking to be considered, dangerous for your health? Because I think that could be a good point to push from your
right. You bring up some very good points. First, the important thing to say, and you've alluded to this, there's no safe level of exposure. So even a little bit is not good for you. And in terms of the distance, it depends on the wind. It depends on whether it's inside, whether it's outside. What we do know is that in multi-unit housing, there's extraordinary exposure. Even if you're in a non-smoking an apartment, if someone's smoking in this multi-unit house, things go through the ventilation systems, through the hallways, et cetera, et cetera. And that becomes an issue. And so, regulatory-wise, for instance, our federally funded housing for low-income families requires that multi-unit housing be smoke-free. And increasingly, that's become the norm. And it sounds like it's going to be difficult, but it was difficult to get smoking out of bars. And that happened, and now it's the norm. And so people expect it. When it comes to, exposure, as you're asking about, it doesn't take much. Right now, we're saying you should stay 6 feet apart to avoid getting contaminated with SARS, COVID-19. And that would mean, that's sort of the minimum. But just depends on all sorts of environmental conditions. And so there is no real safe exposure. One of the things that's going on also, as I mentioned, there are many communities that are saying no smoking outdoors for not just the exposure of secondhand smoke, but for the cigarette butts. That's an objective now here in San Diego, is that all smoking outdoors in public spaces would be eliminated. And I know it sounds draconian, but we're down to 11% smokers. So it's not as hard when you get down that low to actually get those kinds of laws that are good for the public and good for the environment to work.
Great, thank you, Thomas, and thank you as well. Yes, Ali, we'll take the last question from you. Ali Foley.
Hello from Australia. It's very late here, but I'm so excited to see you, Professor. My question for you is, in relation to reducing the prevalence of cigarette butts in our environment, what are your views on using alternate language, separating smoking from littering to avoid the public backlash and the perceived defense of smoking as a right versus littering as an offense?
A lot of people say smoking is a right, an individual right. Mm-hmm. Well, in no constitution, no ethical principle that says there's a right to smoke, especially since it has secondary effects, just as our last questioner mentioned. It's other people's right to breathe clean air. I mean, that's a superseding right. But you're right. I think it's a really good point that you're making, because most people respond positively about, let's prevent, contamination of the environment. And I think that's why there's been success, is actually it's been the environmentalists that have actually had more success at trying to get tobacco product waste reduced and to be, and to advocate for that. When you have, public health people like me with the nanny state saying, oh, you've got to do this and you've got to do that and you've got to quit eating fat and you got to quit, doing whatever, that just turns people off. And so the important thing, I think, is to join these forces just as you're trying to do right here, is to bring this environmental consciousness that more and more people have, and especially in places like Australia or California, the coastal areas, and make that the source of the intervention. I agree with you completely, and I think it's important that the public health people and the environmental people bring this focus together.
Thomas Novotny, thank you so much. Big round of applause, everybody. A great talk. I know you can't hear it, Thomas, but I can see it on all the screens where everyone is applauding jubilantly. So thank you so much, Thomas, for that and for the great questions too. We will be having a panel discussion at the end, but just for time's sake, we will skip merrily along. And we are going from the United States of America now to Poland. And we're going to be talking to Miquel, Garau, and Miquel is talking about a mountain of shame and chalk of shame. Sounds intriguing. So to explain everything, Miquel, it's over to you.
Hello, everyone. First of all, I'm amazed that 91 people is watching here and then in the replay on YouTube. That's going to be amazing. So today, I hope I'm going to inspire here many of you. So if you're ready, let's go for it. We're going to share these slides and we start. Okay, can you see the slides?
Yes, we can. Yep, absolutely.
Okay, so in that way, let's start. My name is Miquel Garau. I am the founder of No More Cigarette Butts on the Ground. I started in Spanish. And today I'm going to talk about the three strategies to empower you to get the message across and to show the problem and to make people talk about the problem. So if you are ready, I think I have 7 minutes to inspire you. So let's go. Let's start with the message. I started collecting cigarette butts when I was in Barcelona, and here you can see plastic bottles full of cigarette butts. But I did the mistake when I started, and the mistake was that there was no message in the bottles or not in my t-shirt. But then I created this t-shirt that you see, black color, that says no more cigarette butts on the ground. And also the message in the backside here, you can see me, no más colillas en el suelo. And also here you can see the message alone is like sad, but when we are a lot of people collecting cigarette butts and here jumping and shouting, no more cigarettes, no more cigarettes, and the bottle over the head, that was an amazing moment in Barcelona, an amazing event to spread the message around. So what will I say at the beginning is, if you go collect cigarette butts and you don't want people to see like you are a crazy person, you better put a message like love the planet and everyone is going to understand what you are doing. Well, this picture here went viral. I have seen this picture of me everywhere. And I can tell you that people were telling crazy stories, telling that I was a famous rapper, that I was living in Greek. I never been in Greek, guys. I never been a rapper. So you better write a message on the boxes. The planet is not an ashtray. That was Mallorca. I was every summer, I go to visit my family and I pick up cigarette butts before going to take a swim. So put the message on the boxes. The planet is not an ashtray, the most important message I want to give. So if you want to say that I'm a rapper, I'm okay with that. But the planet is not an ashtray is the message I want to give. So please put the message you want people to copy and reply. Another picture of that. And well, you know that cigarette butts are very toxic. So can you guess why I went under the cigarettes? Here it goes again. I wanted to give a message. Tobacco is killing people and the environment. So when I do the actions, I don't use my head, I use my heart. And I wanted to give the message so hard that I wanted to say, people, 7 million people die every year because of tobacco. And the effect on the environment is so huge. So let's go to the second strategy. Please always use the message on your action. The second strategy, mountain of shame. It was my big need to make people talk, to make people see the problem. So I came up with an idea. Why don't we collect all cigarettes and then we put them all together. So here it goes. This is the mountain of shame. Please welcome the mountain of shame in your lives, because it's going to make your action be more powerful. This is Mallorca beaches, where we were collecting cigarettes, but one by one in the natural, in the very natural place. So here, this is only a few people, because actually we were more people over there, and all media was there, and the picture is there, the videos are there, and we say, no more cigarette butts on the ground. We were shouting and spreading the message. As you see, 260,000 cigarette butts, that's amazing. But what's more amazing than that? Asking leaders to do mountains of shame in their countries, because this is going to inspire Mallorca people. But if you want to inspire people from other countries, you better show the problem of your country with your people. So here you are, Mexico. Here you are, Argentina, with 80,000 cigarette butts collected. Here you are, Barcelona, with our team of Nomas Colias and other groups like WWF and other groups. And that one is going to be one of the speakers today is Jason Alexander from Rubbish Walks. He did a mountain of shame in summer 2019. So thank you very much for inspiring UK. And this is a very great leader, 10 minutes a day, B Belgium, is Jean-Paul Mels. And he did his own mountain of shame. That is great. So thank you very much. My smile seeing you guys is, and this is from Leo Not Happy. Leo comes from Leonardo DiCaprio, and this group is doing amazing. And I'm going to tell you the story. They collected in one day, 240 people, 2 hours, they collected 270,000 cigarette butts.
Wow.
Okay, people. So to finish this mountain of shame, I am from Mallorca. I was living in Barcelona. I moved to Poland, and you will ask why. Well, first of all, to do a mountain of shame, but secondly, love. So make sure to do a mountain of shame and do a picture with your lovely pet, lovely girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever you have, and spread love everywhere you go. So, and this, to finish, to really finish the mountain of shame, do you know this flag? This is from Galapagos. Galapagos, one of the most natural islands with the giant turtles. And one guy, one man, 70 years old, he picked up more. This is near 1 million cigarette butts collected in a natural place where you cannot enter orange fruit because it can change the biosystem of the island. So please don't throw cigarette butts and do something to prevent the problem. Let's go with the last strategy, a powerful strategy. This time I'm asking, please don't pick up cigarette butts, but please educate the smokers. So let's go with chalk of shame. Chalk of shame is about having chalk on your hand and doing circles on the ground to show people this is only minerals. First of all, the story starts with Patrick Perreguet, a friend, a leader that I have in Poznań, now I live in Wrocław, and he, for the first time, did a circle to a cigarette, and I say, wow, that's a powerful idea. So I came up with the idea of the name Chalk of Shame, and together we do these actions, and sometimes in Poznań, me in Wrocław, and this is what it's about. You chalk the cigarette, you make people see the cigarette when they walk on the street. Without chalk, they are not going to see the cigarette. So this is the bus station next to my home. I hope you love what you see. I can tell you that everyone gonna love this. Why? This is a educational project. This is about making people see and talk about that problem. How are we gonna solve the problem? Well, we will see, but we have many braids connected and for the first time pronouncing this word cigarette butt, because probably in their entire life they never talked about cigarette butts. So this is another picture. I think it looks good. And the best of all, you go away and the chalk is still there. The chalk is still working for you. You go your home, because picking up cigarette butt is cool. But after you being on the street, the action is gone. But chalk remains there maximum 1 month and is minerals. So don't worry for the chalk, get worried for the cigarette butt that is plastic, single-use plastic. 5 minutes in your mouth and more than 10 years on the environment. Between this picture and this picture, something is missing here. Yes, of course, the message. So I started writing the message, cigarettes on the floor. So when you see the picture, you know that every circle is gonna be a cigarette. But there was another problem. This is in Polish, Peta na ziemi. So it was better to do a sign, draw attention, cigarettes. And you don't need to speak Polish or other language. This is international. Please circle the cigarettes and show everywhere. To continue, I'm going to tell you that please put chalk on people's hands, because if you want, everyone has something to say, to give a message, no? So put the chalk on people's hand and let's go for it. You can be very creative. In this case, it's also near my home. And I say, hey, people, don't you see the trash bin? Come on. So I did this piece of art that I hope you like it and you're gonna do it. Don't have fear. If someone put a ticket on you, please tell me and I'd be glad to pay half of the ticket with you. Oh, let's go. Of course, this is a movement. It's only 3 months that we started, Patrick and I, but it's already in India. India love chalk of shame too. And they put a lot of the messages. Who else is doing chalk of shame? The Germans. Schankreise, please shout with me. It sounds very powerful. Schankreise. So only one person can do an amazing job. And if we do that with hundreds of people, 1 hour, we can mess the whole city. This is to educate smokers. This is a very serious issue. But if we can have fun with that, why not? So again, next to my home, here you see a dad with a kid. This is super because you can educate your kids while you are showing this, and kids always ask that, what is that? And of course, we can remind people, especially in Poland, you cannot smoke in the bus station or during the COVID situation that we must wear the face mask. Also, is not allowed to down the mask and smoke. So I put the sign to remind people that is not allowed to smoke in public here in the bus station. And this is the last slide for you. I hope you like the presentation. This is the views from Patrick's Perrier balcony. If you live near someone that is doing chalk of shame, you better don't throw cigarettes on the ground from the balcony. A very common issue. Before, you didn't see cigarettes. When you do chalk of shame, then you realize how many cigarette butts are over there. Thank you very much. My name is Miquel Garau. I hope you love the presentation. I hope I inspire some of you to take the mountain of shame or chalk of shame ideas. You can follow Nomas Colias en el Suelo on Facebook, or chalk of shame, or Miquel Garau. I'll be glad to help you. Thank you very much, and that's all for
my fantastic, Miguel. Thank you so much. Stop sharing your screen so we can see you again. That was a brilliant presentation. I know you inspired so many, and we're really grateful that you joined us from all the way in outer space. We have to have excuses to use all these sound effects, but Miguel, that was really inspiring. And that chalk of shame is such an effective, good idea. And I loved what you said, even when you're gone home and you're sleeping for the night, the chalk is still working for you and people are still seeing it 24/7. So as you stop to share your screen, Miguel, so we can see.
I'm looking for where.
He's coming to us live from the International Space Station.
Is already done?
No, you're still on your screen. It's a beautiful screen, though. We're seeing the behind the scenes of your PowerPoint. 41
slides.
Yeah,
yeah. Sorry.
Your full battery. It's looking good. Great. Does anyone have any questions for Miguel? Please unmute your microphone. Now, we're a bit behind schedule, so we might take just one. So if someone would like to ask Miguel a question, unmute. Tell us where you're from and your name and ask your question.
Hello.
Yes, we heard a female voice there first. Do you want to say your name and where you're from?
Okay. My name is Anti. I'm from Indonesia. Such a great inspiration for me to have a new model of campaign for the cigarette, to reducing the cigarette. But the one point that I want to ask for Miga first, what kind of goals do you want to put in this campaign? I mean, like, you want to put, you want to ask people for reducing the their activity to smoke, or just let the people who smoke to put their cigarette into the trash bag or something?
Thank you for your question. Well, this speech was about empowering you to take action about the cigarette butt problem that is so big. So what's going to be the solution? I was not talking about that. I was just talking about how can you show the problem and how can you make people talk about the problem. So don't worry too much about what the solution is going to be. It's about having everyone see the problem and get to know that one cigarette lasts more than 10 years on the environment. This is single-use plastic, and this is not biodegradable and full of chemicals.
Great stuff, Miguel.
So one cigarette, one circle.
Yes, and I see that just very quickly before we move on, Mr. Lengar, you were going to ask a question?
Well, I'm Paul from Sierra Leone, West Africa. I think I've listened to the previous presentation by the gentleman. You know, he's actually doing a very great job. But my concern is for Africa as a continent, because you know, Africa is one of the largest cigarette consuming continents in the world. And I believe, you know, this campaign is actually very good for a country in order to be able to, you know, actually be cigarette free or cigarette smoke free, because I've actually been following up with some, you know, campaigns in UK, you know, putting bans on cigarette smoking in public places, you know, and which is very nice. But for me, I think Africa is not actually ready because for such a campaign. What I would like to know from him is that he share with us some of his advocacy strategies or campaign strategies, so we'll be able to adopt and see how far we would be able to move from where he has already started. So that's just a concern I'm raising.
Okay. I didn't understand exactly what's the question, but I can tell that there are so many strategies to follow. But just to give you an example, why the trash bins have no message written on there, like saying, love Poland, love Africa, these cigarettes will be transformed in something else. When you don't put a message, it's like you are not inspiring people to take in care. To put another example, I think smokers don't use the brain when they buy the cigarettes, because nobody wants to harm their bodies when they use the brain. This is something emotional. So the response is not always in a rational way. We also have to give a response in an emotional way. So what touches your heart that you want to take care of you? You want to take care of others or the planet? Is connecting with people. So let's practice more relationship, more connecting with people, and more love in everything we do.
More love, education, education, education. Miguel, thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Lengar in West Africa, and to everyone for your fantastic questions. We're moving on because we want to give everyone an equal amount of time and leave enough time for the panel discussion at the end. So next we're going to Holger, one of our hosts in Germany, in Munich. Holger, guten Tag. Wie geht's du?
Yeah, mute, unmuted, perfect. Yeah, it's perfect. Perfect day, perfect conference, I think. It's the best conference this year so far from the student world. So yeah, that would be perfect.
Great. And you were talking about, Holger, how to prevent cigarette butts in cooperation with municipalities. So over to you, Holger.
So, thank you.
And if you can come nice and close to your microphone, Holger, so we can hear it clearly.
Okay, so better, hopefully.
That's better, yeah.
That's better, fine. Yeah, my name is Holger Holland. I'm the president from Let's Do It Germany. And what I want to talk about in the next minutes is how to prevent cigarette butts in cooperation with municipalities. Last year in Germany, we focused completely on CBL, cigarette butt littering. Here we see some pictures from the area of Munich, from the river Isar. And we create some projects together with schools, and we go out, collect cigarette butts, and yeah, collect it and yeah, make a measurement of it. Yeah, so because education was one of our points we want to, yeah, to start, to come in communication with the kids, with the education part, but all very important is the municipality, because everything what we started last year, all the projects, I will explain later some of them, depends in cooperations with municipalities, because without the cooperation, we can do a lot, we can be active, really active, but if you not have the support from the city and the city government and all these parts, then the outcome is not 100%. And also, if you look at the figures, we have European, according to the European Commission, cigarette butts represent the largest fraction of public garbage within the plastic screw, the section of plastic, within 19%. And also another, this is a German figure, VKU, Association of Municipal Enterprises, with 17,000 communities, is this the association, the umbrella of them. And they selected it that cigarette butts in cities is approximately 35% of the total littering in public area. So it's a huge issue, a huge problem. And so we start some projects. One of the projects is so far called the Pocket Ashtray Butt Buddy. It's not something new, because we know that trash pockets are or trash or mobile ashtrays are a really good tool to create awareness in the public sector. But we make something new. We make a joint venture between local companies, the industry, and the municipalities to create something new, because we make a completely new product design, and it's built, it's a recyclate. So we use recycled plastic from the German automotive industry, create this ashtray, and this will be used up from this year in awareness campaigns in big cities. This is one, yeah, and it also shows what we are. We are collaboration, and it was possible with the industry and with the municipality to make the product design and the product, so the whole production is finished by now within 3 months. And this shows how important our corporations in this part are. Yes, this part I can make a little bit shorter now, because Miquel, speaker before me, talk a lot about the Shark of Shame. It's perfect. It's a perfect awareness project. And also it shows, yes, Poland and Germany, what are our network, or for what we are possible, what we can do globally if we work together and if we make a know-how transfer of our projects. So to talk about, like on this conference, is perfect to make to copy paste some great projects. This is one of them. This is taken over by City Cleaners in Germany, is one of our partners in Germany. It's also really strong in the World Cleanup Day in Germany. And yeah, it works really good, because and it's also accepted by the municipality. This is a very important point. You can do a lot, but you have the connection and to communicate with the public, also with the PR, also with the press. That is one part. Yeah, because do good things and talk about. This is one part, but also with the municipality. And in Germany, in the last years, we see that the exception of our campaigns and projects will be, they 3, 4, 5 years ago, they don't talk with us. Meanwhile, they ask us about how we can do it. Can you help maybe? What do you think about? And this shows how it grows, and we are on a really good track. And not only in Germany, I think worldwide is this the part. And here, yes, Schandkreise, perfect German word for that, talk of shame, is sozusagen copy-pasted from the global idea. Another part, awareness campaign in Saarland also takes over to make it visible, yes, because cigarette butts are small things and you have to understand how big the global impact is. And these guys, in this case, Arno and the Clean Up Saarland team create really cool projects. They make transparent pillars and where they put in the cigarette butts to count the amount of them. In this case, on the right side, we see 35,000 butts. They poison 1.4 million liters of water. And this, this is equal 3 outdoor swimming pools. This is, huge, and it's visible. This is one of the biggest outcome also from our projects. You must make the problem visible. And in this case, the pillars are really helpful. Yeah, and last but not least, the most important cigarette butt campaign or anti-cigarette butt littering campaign are cleanups. And here we see some pictures on the right side. In the middle, in the background, we see the European Central Bank. This is Frankfurt. So we see that municipality, the financial sector has the same issue. We collected on World Cleanup Day in this area, cigarette butts, yes, but also normal trash. But the cleanup has the highest awareness impact for this problem. So we are on a really good way in Germany. We have activated last year more than 400 municipalities in more than 1,200 cleanups, activate more than 80,000 participants. With these figures, we are really, really happy, this I must say. So also on this channel, thank you to all the audience and to all the supporters also in Germany. You see a lot of you here in the room. Thanks for participating on the, Let's do it, World Conference 2021. Last but not least, one of the best effective, I think, effective campaign is organized by the municipality by self. And if you throw away a cigarette, you see here on the list the penalties in Berlin. If you if you are catched, then you have to pay 120 euro for one cigarette butt. This you will only do once, I think. And in Munich, this is a little bit different, but also 55 euro, it hurts. Yeah, and it shows everybody must work together. Municipality, we as a social movement or organization, and also the politic. Yeah. If you want to have more information about our projects in Germany, my name is Holger Holland. I'm president of Let's Do Germany. And yes, Colm.
Thank you so much, Holger. Dankeschön. Very good. And what was that word again for chalk of shame? The German word for chalk of shame?
Schandkreise.
Schandkreiser. Schandkreiser. Ich liebe Schandkreise und starken Laufen. Sorry, guys. That will get into me. Holger, that was fantastic. I know we're out of time and I appreciate because Holger is the official timekeeper of the conference and he's messaging me here on another screen, kicking my butt because people are going over. So you didn't go over, Holger. Would anyone like to ask Holger a quick question about Schankreichstaffenstufen? Come on, guys. Show some love to our German friends. One quick question from anyone or we'll move on. Holger, you were so comprehensive. Nobody has any questions because you covered everything inside out, upside down, back to front. German efficiency. Thank you, Holger. And congratulations on running such a fantastic conference. Big round of applause to Holger from Let's Do It Germany, the host of this year's conference. Now let's go from Germany to the United Kingdom and to Jason Alexander, a man I've had the pleasure of interviewing before. He is great. And good question, his presentation, why should I care? Most of us, if we keep our heads up walking around, we won't see the cigarette butts. won't affect us too badly. Why should we care, Jason?
That's a good question. Shall I start straight away?
There's never been a better time.
Great stuff. So can everyone see my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen. Oh, that looks very disturbing, but we can see it.
Magic. Okay. So hello, everyone. Fantastic to be here. And it's great to hear all of the what everyone has been saying up to this point. It's really interesting to get all of those different perspectives. So I thought what I chat about today is my perspective here in the UK. So my name is Jason Alexander. I'm the founder of Rubbish Walks. We're a small social enterprise based here in the UK, and we work tirelessly across the country and beyond, trying to raise awareness about the issues of single-use plastics, litter, and waste in general. And it's about collaborating and getting involved with as many people as we can to try and get them out there and actually doing something. And we've got a little phrase that we say on most of our walks and on the front page of our website as well. So if you want to change the world, you can't just talk the talk, you have to walk the walk too. And that's what we're all about. You can't just click like and share on social media. You've got to get out in the real world and actually start doing something. And my journey started about 4 or 5 years ago. And I set myself a challenge to witness and photograph 100 sunrises in a year. And that's more difficult than it sounds here in the UK, because we wake up in the morning and there's lots of grey skies and lots of rain. But it was a fantastic challenge, and I got to visit lots of lovely places, witness lots of lovely sunrises. But there was something that kept bugging me whenever I went out on my walks, and that was wherever I went, no matter how beautiful the location, there was litter around. And as we know, it comes in all different shapes and sizes. Beautiful scenes, but spoiled by trash left behind by visitors to those locations. And rather than ignore it, I thought I need to actually try and do something about it. So I set up Rubbish Walks, and we organised lots of different events around the UK. So we do lots of beach cleans, lots of river cleans, lots of litter picks, and I spend lots of time trying to create interesting content to share on social media to try and get people interested, spark their interest, and actually get them out there doing something as well. But one of the key things is about having fun. So we try and make it, it's a really, really serious topic, but if we can inject a little bit of fun in there, then we can really drive up the engagement and get lots and lots of people involved. And we get lots of people involved, different ages, different locations. So we get lots of young children involved. So we work closely with schools, with sheltered housing for the older generation, with local businesses. So we get involved with as many people as we can. And back in 2018, I done a beach clean marathon. So I walked the length of the Suffolk coast, about 90 kilometres, picking up litter, picking up trash as I went, and generated lots of interest. I had lots of helpers come along the way. But I had a time scale that I needed to keep to. I had a set distance I needed to cover every single day. We picked up lots of litter, but there was one common item that I saw wherever I went. You guessed it, it's cigarette butts. And everywhere I went, whether it was on the beach, walking into the towns, going back to the car park, being picked up and by car, everywhere we look, we see cigarette butts. And as already been mentioned before, it's rather smelly. It's a huge problem. And I decided that when I finished the beach clean, that I would trying to raise the issues around cigarette butts one of my key issues, one of the key topics that I would try and cover moving forward. And when I done or started to do lots of research online and chatting to local people here in Ipswich, we were coming up with lots of, hearing lots of excuses. And I'm sure if we go through some of these quickly, you've come across these as well. So it doesn't matter whether you're in the UK, Germany, Spain, Poland, Australia, wherever, we hear the same kind of excuses. So not aware it's littering, didn't know that they contain plastic. You can see the different reasons on there. And what I wanted to try and do was to try and think of a way of being able to tackle all of those excuses. So I came up with my solution here in the UK called the four E's. So I break it down into to these four elements. So we've got education, easy access, EPR, extended producer responsibility, and enforcement. And a lot of these have already been covered by the great speakers beforehand. And the EPR, extended producer responsibility, putting up responsibility onto the producers of, in this instance, the cigarette butts and cigarette waste, hugely, hugely important, as is enforcement. If the smoker sees that there is no consequence, or litterers in general, if they say that there's no consequence for dropping that litter, then we see those litter rates go up. The slight downside with EPR and enforcement is that there are things that you can do to try and drive that change, but most of that is out of your control. That's down to the big brands and government to actually implement those changes. We can try and push that, but it's a little bit out of our control. So I concentrate quite a lot on the education and easy access side of things. And I do that in a number of different ways. So from an education point of view, I try to use visual elements as much as I can. So a year or so ago, I started my 1 million butts campaign. And as you can guess by the name, I've been out as often as I can picking up cigarette butts and sharing those images on social media as much as I can. And the key thing here is I do it fairly locally to here to where I live. And it's about getting out and people seeing that you being visible so people can see what you're actually trying to do. And as you can see there from that slide, at the moment I've collected 802,270. And I know that because I've counted every single one of them. That's still going fantastically. You can see from this image here, a little bit of inspiration from Miquel there. But you know, visual images work really well when it comes to try and get the message across about the issues of cigarette butts and the fact that they belong in a bin and not on the ground. And one of the things that I was really pleased about, you know, you've kind of, we hear about seeing your name in on the big screen or in lights. Well, I actually got to see my face and on the side of the refuse trucks driving around our town with the messaging about cigarette butts. But what I also wanted to do was to try and get as many people involved as I could. So I introduced in 2019 National Blitz the Butt Day, and that went absolutely fantastically. In the first year, 2019, we had a fantastic response, and we collected tens of thousands of, it was well over 100,000 cigarette butts across the UK. And lots of people involved, and it was absolutely fantastic. 2020, a little bit more difficult with COVID and social distancing, but it was still a fantastic event because we changed up a couple of things. The first thing was that we actually tied in and teamed up with World Cleanup Day. So we ran our Blitz the Butt Day on World Cleanup Day as well, which really helped to drive engagement. And one of the other things that we really wanted to do was to not just throw the cigarette butts away. Here in the UK, we have we don't really have any infrastructure for dealing with cigarette butts. We have TerraCycle, and they offer a scheme, but it's a paid for scheme. So I was really, really pleased to come across the guys at FiltraCycle, and we'll be hearing about FiltraCycle. I'm really interested to hear how they're getting on. But this is all of the cigarette butts that were collected during the 2020 Blitz the Butt Day that went off to FiltraCycle to help them with their development. And the last thing I just wanted to leave you with was from an education point of view, my background is in electronics and product design, and I've developed the world's first charity cigarette butt bin. So the idea here is that local businesses, local authorities sponsor the bin, and as smokers use the bin, as it fills up, we can see that it generates donations to local charities. Now that can help with cleanup, but it could be any charity. And as you can see there, I've also got our version of the trash pocket, the portable ashtray, but we're using a little tin there. We have a website. Things have been on hold a little bit because of COVID, but we're really going to be pushing this again soon. And I'm conscious of the time here, so we've covered all of those elements. So I just leave you with this last post. It's been absolutely fantastic listening to things so far, and I'm really looking forward to hearing the speakers afterwards as well. But this just goes to show, if we all work together, we truly can make a difference.
Jason, lovely words to end on. And I liked as well as your face on the side of the refuge truck, no ifs, no buts. Good play on words. And you're right, the images work so well. And someone who works in media, stories are much easier sold to newspapers and media outlets when there's good images and video to go with them, and they sell themselves. So we have to really move on. But if we have one quick question for Jason, or else you'll get a chance at the end to ask a question. So very quickly, if you'd like to ask a question, now's your chance. 3, 2, 1, 0. You can ask a question at the end. Jason, thank you so much. We're going to my home country now, to Ireland. And we're going to talk to Rory McMahon. People are clapping, by the way, Jason. Rory, this is an amazing thing. We talked about this on World Cleanup Day itself. It's called FiltraCycle, recycling cigarette butts to keep them out of the ocean. Rory McMahon, and before we came on air or started the conference, Rory was complaining. What did you say the weather was like today in Ireland, Rory?
Grey, wet and miserable.
Wet and miserable. Well, yeah. To make you feel extra at home here in the conference, listen to the sound we have for you. Can you hear that rain?
I can already hear it from outside the window, but thank you very much.
There's good old rain coming in there, sound effects. Well, listen, it's over to you. This is a fascinating initiative, and take it away. Tell us all about it.
I'll just get cracking into it. I'm conscious of the time, and Jason has already given me a great introduction, so thank you for that. Okay, so here we go. Can everyone see that all right?
Yes, indeed. Yep.
All right. So, hi, everyone. I would like to thank the guys from World Cleanup Day for having us on. And obviously, thank you to everyone for attending as well. My name is Rory McMahon, and I am the Chief Marketing Officer over here at FiltraCycle. Briefly, we are an Irish startup based out of Dublin. And we've had the privilege in the last year of working with representatives from World Cleanup Day to tackle the catastrophic problem of cigarette waste, which obviously needs no introduction. In this presentation, I want to just kind of reiterate a few of the things that have already been said by Miguel, Thomas and Jason, and I will explain what basically our solution is to that problem. There we go. So firstly, just a few of the most shocking statistics that you've already heard today. I just wanted to reiterate, obviously cigarette butts are the single most common item of litter on the planet. And like 6 trillion is a pretty unfathomable figure. And the biggest problem when we came to the table that we noticed was that obviously that's shocking enough in itself, which you've already heard today, but that currently there is no real route through which they are not harmful. For pretty much 99% of those cigarette butts, bar the ones that are currently being recycled by startups like us, the best case scenario for them is that they end up in a bin or an ashtray, and then they just end up in landfill where they still decompose and release carbon dioxide and toxins into the atmosphere. So other butts that break down in terrains, poison soil, or are eaten by animals, as was extensively talked about by Thomas. But the vast majority of them will end up in our oceans, and that's where they are most devastating, and I will touch on that later. They have thus become one of the most toxic water pollutants, which is kind of what brought our attention to them in the first place. They're not just really another abstract environmental problem which we see on Instagram but never actually face in our daily lives. They are in every crevice of our cities, our beaches, our parks, and our oceans, as you saw in Jason's photos, and they are polluting the air we breathe and the water that we drink with toxins. In fact, shockingly, most urban drinking water contains trace amounts of nicotine. And that is just kind of hits home how insidiously invasive they really are. However, the most devastating fate of a cigarette butt is when they inevitably nearly always end up in the ocean. So 2/3 of them end up in there, and they're washed into storm drains and carried out to sea because, as has been talked about extensively, they're still one of the last socially acceptable manners of littering, and they're often flicked onto the street, which is a huge part of the problem. So it's been great to see guys like Miquel raising awareness around that. Because they're made of plastic, they obviously break down into thousands of fibers of microplastics, and plankton eat them. And when the plankton die and float to the top of the surface of the ocean's ability to take carbon out of the atmosphere is severely damaged, and the toxic chemicals contained in the butt can poison up to 80 liters of water. And that's just from one butt. So obviously when you have a figure like 6 trillion, it becomes problematic very quickly. The more research we did, the more we just couldn't believe that we hadn't heard anything about it. Because every smoker knows that it's bad for themselves, but they don't always know that it's bad for not only those around them, but for also the environment. The more obvious it became to us that this colossal waste problem needed to be solved. And we knew we had to find a way to intervene at some stage in the journey of the cigarette butt to try and capture it between its usage and its decomposition in the ocean. And the solution we devised to that was FiltraPlastic. So essentially, we recycle the butts into a plastic that can be used in consumer products. For instance, we collected 1 million cigarette butts through World Cleanup Day representatives and ourselves, and produced plastic from our pilot, which is now being used with Amber Eyewear to make sunglasses and blue light glasses. A single pair of these sunglasses is keeping 4,000 cigarette butts, contains 4,000 recycled cigarette butts out of the ocean, and would save 2.6 million liters of water from the toxic chemicals which we remove and the plastic we recycle. So that's just one pair of the sunglasses that we would be selling through other companies. And the method that we use is actually quite simple. Basically, in the last year or two, through any means open to us, we have collected as much cigarette waste as possible. The butts then undergo our unique recycling process, which transforms them from an obsolete item of waste into a valuable consumer product. And companies which are trying to use sustainable alternatives, I know Patagonia and Nike and some really big companies have been doing a lot of great work with ocean plastic companies in the last while that are using recycled plastic instead of virgin plastic. For instance, they can purchase our plastic for use in their own products as a sustainable alternative. So it's not only taking the cigarette butts out of the ocean, but it's also displacing new plastic. This thermoplastic is called cellulose acetate. It's the same plastic that's in cigarette butts, but it's in a different form. It's fibrous. It's found in many other products, which make it ideal for use as a recycled plastic. And our filter plastic can be made into essentially everything short of medical or food grade packaging. So our collection has been based on two primary sources. Firstly, volunteer collection, and secondly, our receptacles, which we install in densely populated areas. For our first pilot, which we did just there in December and January, we managed to collect and recycle 1 million cigarette butts. And I'd like to actually take this opportunity to thank the representatives at World Cleanup Day and the other volunteer organizations who did the actual work on the ground with us, particularly Jason Alexander, whose efforts were nothing short of Trojan. The team at World Cleanup Day, as well as Rubbish Walks, Upcycle and BTV, were absolutely vital, and it was a great international initiative to be able to collect and recycle 1 million cigarette butts, and it's something that we're very proud of. Our second stream, and something we're trying to develop, is from the state-of-the-art filter bins that we've designed. So it's basically a smart bin designed specifically to provide smokers with a receptacle for butts in litter hotspots. So the filter bin, the first smaller one you can see there, would be in nightclubs and at concerts and in places where people are going to be inclined to smoke more. And then the filter bin plus can be put in, like, you know, outside of densely populated areas in the city next to bins. So it's not only raising awareness about the problem, but it's also giving smokers an alternative place to put it where it won't go to landfill and won't go into the ocean, but will actually be dealt with. Here are just some of the photos of our pilot and the butts, which we collected ourselves and had sent to us from Jason and the other representatives at World Cleanup Day. This has protected millions of liters of ocean water and kept colossal amounts of toxic waste out of our ecosphere. And we are only just getting started. Once we've established ourselves properly in Ireland, our process from filter bin to recycling plant can be replicated internationally. And by 2030, we aim to recycle 20% of the EU cigarette waste. Hopefully people will stop smoking altogether one day. When that day comes, we will happily shut our doors and close shop. But until then, we intend on proactively trying to solve the problem and try and keep our oceans clean. Yeah, if you have any interest in purchasing our plastic or just any questions in general, please feel free to visit our website and contact us or get in touch with us through our social media, which I'll post in the threads of the comments. Thank you all for listening.
Rory, Trojan, as always, to use your word. That was fantastic and great Irish company. Anyone have any questions for Rory? By the way, Rory, do you have a pair of the sunglasses there in the room?
I don't have a pair with me because they're being developed by another company. We sell the plastic to a company called Amber Eyewear, who are making their glasses with our plastic.
Fantastic. It's such a great idea. I know when we did the TV show, people were intrigued by it. So you can stop sharing your screen, Rory, and we can see the gallery view again. If anyone would like to ask Rory a question. Thomas, I think you have a question.
Yeah. Hi, Rory. That's really fantastic to hear what you're doing and ambitious. Terrific. But I have a question about the toxicity again. And what are you doing to either protect your workers or to test and make sure that products don't have this chemical toxicity that we've been talking about, because nicotine is pretty much a recognized toxic hazardous waste product in and of itself, and these things are going to contain that. So anything you can tell us about how you detoxify or protect your workers, etc., during this whole process?
Yeah, of course. Thanks for asking, Thomas. So I was actually one of the workers on the line during the pilot, so I can tell you lots about that. There's only six of us who work for the company right now, and we all kind of pitch in and do everything. So we were all actually on the line working on the recycling process. We're not just handling the business side of things. So we obviously were kitted out with full PPE. We had masks, we had detectors to pick up if there was any problems with chemicals and stuff. So we were all very much protected and we were all very cognizant, because obviously cigarette waste and the volumes that we were storing it can be very harmful. There was another question that you had asked as well.
The product itself, whether or not you tested.
That is why we ran our pilot just gone. We have the plastic has been sent off to a lot of different laboratories, most notably the one in our college, which is Trinity College Dublin, where it's undergoing lots of different tests to make sure that there is virtually no trace amounts of nicotine left. And it is just clean cellulose acetate. But from the tests that have been done so far, we're pretty confident that it is clean and perfectly safe for consumer use.
And Trinity College, I can attest, is Ireland's top university as well. So Rory, thanks for that. And Thomas, great question as well. And we're going to move on to our final speaker because of timing. Patrick Ingell, who is in Sweden, and he is talking about trash pocket. Let's bin the butts. A trash bag in your pocket or trash pocket. So Patrick, it's over to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Well, fantastic conference, and what a fantastic speakers, and be here with this cigarette butt panel. It's amazing. I'm really proud. I will start up by saying I'm going to take this talk about the trash bag campaign in 7 minutes. So it's going to be quite short but informative. So yes, let's keep it on. We're going to start up with a little teaser, or I will say just. The real message here, little movie.
Hey, have you seen that smart trash pocket around? Just re-ash, re-trash, reuse, recycle. So convenient, so easy. Ask for it in your local store. Yeah, let's make it a trend to bin the butts.
Yes, and when the message, we have talked about it, the previous talk, when the message of cigarette butts littering comes into people's mouth, isn't there more important things that care about than those tiny small cigarette butts? Well, the thing is, about 140,000 of them are dropped every single second. So it's kind of literally raining cigarette butts out there. So, and quickly they reach, they reach quickly streams and seas and degrade into microplastic. And nowadays, we even find them in our plates. So not nice, really. If you go around, you go at the beaches, you find them, you find a lot of them at bus stops, at entrance, walking paths, city parks. This means also huge cleanup costs. So if we front the page a little bit, thank you. For example, I will say in Sweden, a little country of Sweden with 10 million people, the yearly cleanup cost due to cigarette butt littering is nearly 80 million euros, almost half the Swedish total cleanup cost. And now to the quick question of this, how come every produced cigarette filters ends up as litter on the streets and in nature? And if we look from the Swedish Natural Defense Agency and study and the most common spotted behavior, I will put out a question from that report that really turned a little spot on this behavior. And that's a question: what was the reason last time you threw a cigarette butt on the ground? And they said there was no ashtray nearby, or the most common question, I was throwing cigarette butts into a trash can because of fire risk. And the last one, I don't want to carry this stinky butt with me because of the smell. So there are 3 points here. So that nearly 90% of the expression that was answered felt it most often inconvenient to make a proper disposal for this leftover cigarette butt, and the reason why they choose to drop it on the ground. Could we spin up with a yes? If you, Holger, if you put up a little more front, if you click a bit, display. Okay, we can turn this around. And I say that bringing the light on the trash pocket campaign solution had the great powers to be an just this inspiring tool and the movement to reduce this, so to say, inconvenient problem. Because that was the expression was saying, 90% says it's really inconvenient. So it just that with trash pocket, that it make it convenient because it's easy, it's sustainable, and it gets the user to get connected and be aware about this issue. And as you see here, it's the simple one. You can put it in the pocket in the shirt really easy. So it fits everywhere, and the best way, it doesn't smell. So if you are at a bus station and you have to, you are in this kind of between two deeds, that's often also common thing that you don't think about it, you throw away the butt and you go to the bus because you don't want to take it with you. The trash pocket can solve this solution. And all this brings me further to the reason and the sense behind this trash pocket campaign. If we go the slides forward a bit, some more, I think, Holger, yes, and one more, yep. Thank you. The trash pocket campaign aims to spread awareness about the cigarette butt littering, and we would like to build up a strong international campaign in the area of pocket ashtray. And we also create the interest in collaborating, willing to work with the TPs and actively participate in bringing them to the hotspots for availability. And this, our Let's Keep It Clean campaign, in our efforts, I would like to proudly present our teamwork and partnership with and collaboration, I would say, with the Let's Do It NGO and the World Cleanup Day organization. We have created a strong common platform for presenting the Trash Pocket campaign. And together we released the Let's Keep It Clean campaign, a world tour trash pocket implementation with a pit stop on the September at the World Cleanup Day. And from that on, we continue the journey to introduce the Trash Pocket campaign. And if you click on the, Holger. Thank you. The campaign will start up in Nairobi, Kenya, together with the national unit and organization of Let's Do It Kenya. And it will be released on the 22nd of March as part of the international event, the UN World Water Day. Can we back the picture a little bit so I can? Sorry.
Back one, Holger, I think he wants.
Yeah, the back second one. Last one. Yeah. We can have that. Thank you, Holger. Yes, and on this day, the 22nd of March, we are going to release it as a part of the international event, the UN World Water Day. And by communicating the hashtag water to me, the campaign aims to spread the reflection about celebrates the clean and fresh waters. And about cigarette butts and water, concerning cigarette butts and waters, the fantastic powerful installation, we need to talk about butts by the Dutch artist, Bierstakker, yes. Showing that and telling that just one single cigarette butt had a negative powers to pollute up to 500 liters of water. And we have been listening to it from FiltraCycle and so forth. It's heavily polluted. And hooking up with the local retailer and with other societal actors, and by spreading the campaign widely and powerful, both digitally and physically, we believe it will be and create interest and encourage the cigarette smokers to ask for trash pockets at the local stores. And from this point, as in the trash pocket campaign moves on, this is where we are now. It's moving fast, and the campaign grows for every day. So it's have been a really powerful autumn here with the focus on cigarette butts, and we are really proud to be a part of that. And I will also like to invite you all to the Trash Pocket Workshop at the 18 UCT, where I would like to get you more insight in the ideas of the campaign. And at the same time, you are able to be part of the party plan, a possible campaign destination as the Trash Pocket World Tour sets off. So let's do it and jump in and be part of the networking there. So the last picture, please. Thank you, Holger. Yes, and thank you for listening to this. It was not really synced with the slides, but that doesn't matter. I think I made the sense of this. And to reach out to us to place an order or find a collaboration, planning a campaign, just send me an email or us an email to info@trashlinepocket.com or enter the trash line pocket. Yeah, the email info@trashpocket.com. Yes.
Patrick, Ingell, Hagerman, that was fantastic. And you know what? It was good that the slides weren't synced up properly because said something and then it reminded us of what you said because we saw it afterwards, or else it told us what you were going to say and you said it. So it
really gave us the
information. You were fantastic. If anyone has a quick question, you can turn off your screen sharing now, Holger, because we're about to go into the panel discussion and there's been a slight change to the panel discussion. But I know we're way over time. So a quick question for Patrick, anyone? That was very comprehensive.
Hello, yes, I have a question.
Yes, from China, yes.
Yeah, I'm NY from China. I also made hundreds of this kind of pocket bag for my personally to give away for free to my friends. But I also see a problem that even they have this pocket, they don't have the habit to put the cigarette butt into the bag. I don't know if you notice the behavior, or do you have any idea how we can encourage them to use it and keep them around them? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I have, because from my point of view, our research at Trash Pocket Team, we see that when you get the trash pocket in the hand and you choose to start to collect, you also choose to not to litter, or you choose to not be being a litter. So it's kind of it's getting it. It's when you choose to be a collector, I would say, you also choose not to litter.
Okay, so you just really have to educate them. And that was a great comment from China as well. It's one thing giving them the pocket, the trash pocket, but making them use it is another thing. Guys, I'm afraid we have to leave it there for just now, but here's what we're going to do, because we also have another room called a lobby. And a lobby is where people kind of hang out and they can have discussions after our time is up. And the reason we have to be so strict with time is because this very Zoom session, the Zoom URL is used for the next one, which is starting soon. So Mart and our speakers who are taking part in the panel discussion, and I think the reason we went so over time is because there's still so much to talk about when it comes to this issue, and it's a really hot topic that everyone is really on fire about. So Mart is now going to moderate a panel discussion about cigarette butts and littering. Thomas will be involved, Jason, Patrick, who you just heard, and Miguel. If you would like to go to it, go to the lobby. Where is the lobby, Colm? Good question. If you go to the chat, they have a link to the lobby. You can see there, Annalie is putting a link. Copy and paste it. Copy and paste the link. Head over to the lobby, guys, to have that panel discussion. It's going to be fascinating. So all our speakers, Jason, Alexander, everyone, head over to the lobby and we free up this room. People are laughing at me. I know I sound nuts, but this is the way we're doing it. But well done to everyone. That was a great session. Round of applause, everybody.